Hey, thank you so much, Andrew, and a huge thank you to the Smart Nation team for inviting us and also for working with us and supporting us throughout this series. We are so excited to be coming back again. We were here last week for an intro to UX design, so I wonder if anyone here is coming from that. If you are, hello to you again, and for all of the new faces, hi. Thank you so much for taking the time off your busy workday to join us. We really appreciate it. All right, so Araka, if I can ask you to move to the next slide. All right. Hi, everyone. So my name is Hu, and I'm the marketing manager for General Assembly Singapore, and I lead marketing for all of Singapore for General Assembly. All right. So for those of you who have just joined us for the very first time and is wondering who General Assembly is and what we do, we are a global tech education company, and we focus on helping people to reskill and upskill themselves in the most in-demand tech skills. So of course, data science being one of them. But as I mentioned before, we also have other topics in courses in other topics as well. So things like coding, UX design, digital marketing, and product management. Right, so some numbers over here. So as I mentioned, we actually started out 10 years ago in US, but we have now expanded to more than 30 global campuses. So in the APAC region, of course, we have our Singapore campus, but we also do have our sister campuses in Australia. So far we have more than 70,000 course alumni, more than 500,000 workshop attendees. So these are usually shorter in time. We also have more than 20,000 expert instructors like Rakav himself who join us on a weekly basis to be able to share more about the industries, more about everything you need to know to break into this particular field. All right, so I think just some number for GAs in Singapore particularly. So GAs is 10 years old this year, but we are established in Singapore in mid-2015. So we have more than 1,000 immersive and part-time graduates. So I know that immersive is a very GA term, but basically it refers to our career-changing courses. So for those of you who are looking to make a very drastic career change, this is the course that you'll be able to attend and make a switch into a totally different field. We also have more than 5,000 workshop participants. So this workshop refer to the shorter workshops that are usually 2.5 hours to 6 hour bootcamp. For those of you who just want to pop in for a quick class to pick up a skills that you need. And then we also have more than 40,000 community events participants. So all of our community events are free. And if you are keen to find out more about, what's happening in the industries, what skills do I need to be prepared for the coming year? What are the up and coming topics? Our community events is a great one to check out. And last but not least, we do have very strong partnership with IMDA. So that's the Infocom Media Development Authority, the employers as well as the tech community. All right, so moving on. So as I mentioned, what we offer is that we do offer courses for you to make a career transformation. So for you who are looking to, break into data science, for example, or break into UX design, you can come and take our full-time course to be able to make that switch. All of our courses are very industry focused. So that means that our instructors are all industry practitioners. So they do bring with them very valuable industry insights as well as everything that you need to know about that particular industry, very updated information in that sense. And we also aim to deliver a great student experience. And when you do join us, you also have access to a great global alumni network who will be able to support you every step of the way. And last but not least, if you are not, ready for a long course just yet, then you can also check out our events and workshops. I will be dropping some links in the chat later on for you to check out. And yeah, so this is some contact details over here. I think it's a little bit hard to read, but there's singapore_admissions@ga.co. Again, I'll drop that in the link later on. So if you have any other further questions, you can feel free to drop us a note in the email over there, and our admissions producer will be sure to get back to you. And of course, a shameless plug to please follow us on our social media platform. So we post about, our community events, any exciting things that are up and coming at GA Singapore. All right, and so I think that's all from me. I will not take any more of your time or pass over the time to Rakav to walk us through intro to data science. Over to you, Rakav.
Thanks, Song. Hey, everyone. Welcome to this session. And very glad to have every one of you here. So my name is Raghav, right? So what we'll cover today is introduction to data science, right? And in brief, the agenda would start with something very basic. What exactly is data science? Why do we need or why everyone is talking about data science, right? So we establish some basic foundations for that. Then we'll go into what data science process looks like in an industry, right? Which is a sort of a framework which can be applied across different data science problems. Then we'll look at some algorithms and some coding bits just to show you how in practice it looks like. And then one of my favorite parts of this would be applications of data science, right? Like we see around us Amazon, Netflix, Spotify, which pieces we use every day, but how are they leveraging data science, right? And how do we experience that, right? And I think one of the important parts which everyone may be very curious is, we won't go in depth, but I would definitely want to share with you how you can start your journey with data science, because there are a lot of things which gets as a question, right? Like what are the first steps we need to take? So I would definitely want to share with everyone what would be the few things you can get started. And definitely we'll have some good amount of time towards the end for any sort of Q&A, right? About the course, about the career, about GA, about Smart Nation. So it could be around pretty much anything. We'll be happy to cover that. Right. So yeah, as I was telling, my name is Raghav. I'm currently working as analytics manager at Grab. So I've been working at Grab for 3+ years now. And I hope a lot of folks in Singapore, from Singapore, and I hope everyone has heard Grab or used Grab at least. Right. So Grab is a super app, right? We have ride hailing, food delivery, payments, fintech, right? So there are a lot of domain specializations or services which Grab provides everyday consumers. So I'm leading the analytics teams for marketplace and fulfillment, where we look at working with different teams to launch different set of products. And the role foundation of our team is, how do we enable better data-driven decisions at Grab, right? So that's the foundation of the role I'm involved in. But in overall, I have around 7+ years of experience in data science and experimentation. So experimentation is a term which I'm not sure if everyone has heard. If heard, that's great. If not, then there is a one of the applications we'll see how companies use experimentation as well. But yeah, before that, I was doing my master's from NUS in business analytics. I did a short capstone internship at DBS. Before that, I was working at United Health Group, which is a healthcare insurance company in US, for over 4 years as a data scientist, majorly looking at marketing analytics, consumer healthcare, and so on. Right. So this is very brief about myself. So before we get started, right, so I think let's take a moment to just appreciate what you see on the screen, right? And why so is, everything we do or talk is about data. So it's very important to just appreciate the numbers which happened in a minute of the day in 2020, right? So how much data were we generating as consumers or for these companies, right? For example, if you look at WhatsApp, 41 million messages are being exchanged on WhatsApp every minute of the day. For Facebook, it's 147,000 photos are being uploaded every minute, right? Instagram, 347K stories, YouTube, 500 hours of video, Spotify ads, 28 tracks, right? So these are like a few examples, but the idea to show here is, this is the scale at which the data is being generated and then leveraged by these companies for better consumer experience, product experience, engagement, and so on, all right? But yeah. So now let's talk about what data science is, right? So in a very simple, the most simple ways I could put when I was thinking to do this was, data science is taking a data-driven way to solve a problem. Like, that's it. It sounds very simple, but the end goal or the foundation or crux is that we use data science to have data-driven way to solve any problem in a business context, operational context, product, and so on. So that is a simple way. But to more academic way, I would say it's combination of using data, which we saw on the previous slide, then some mathematical formulations, algorithms, along with some computer science knowledge and domain knowledge. Domain knowledge is one of the very critical aspects along with everything, because it changes a lot when you move from probably a fintech to a e-commerce, to a retail, to an insurance sector or a manufacturing sector, and so on. And data, the beauty is, data science is applicable and has abundant applications across all sectors, right? So using these to answer business questions, discover relationships, and the most fun part is predicting unknown outcomes and how can we automate decisions for that, right? So the goal is to gain insights and knowledge from any type of data. It could be structured or unstructured. When this is structured, you can think of it as anything which can fit into rows and columns, right? It could be like age, gender, first name, last name, PIN code, right? Everything which can be put in an Excel sheet, rows and columns, you can think of is a structured data. The examples which we were seeing on the previous slide, they were mostly unstructured data, right? When we talk about images, videos, audio, right, or text data, right, or the reviews, comments, and so on. Right? So that is an unstructured data. And how do we leverage unstructured data and structured data? It's something we'll see in the subsequent slides. So this is what data science is. But one of the other questions is, why data science? Like, why do we need data science, right? It's not the world hasn't been existed or the companies haven't existed forever, right? So companies, businesses have existed. Decisions have always been made, right? So I'm not sure, there's a term called HIPPO, right? I'm not sure if you heard, but it's something called highest paid person's opinion. So the usual or the old ways or the old school thought process could be that there is no data science probably in a meeting room, in a discussion, or in a debate, right? What a team should be doing, right? Everybody would have thoughts, opinions, what to do. But end of the day, after the discussion, somebody in the room would raise their hands and say like, hey guys, I know what to do because I have been here for long enough, or I know what's the right thing to do for the company, right? Even you feel that you have the right things to say, but it gets overridden sometimes, right? I hope it doesn't, you have not experienced it, but that's a sort of an old school way of operating, right? And that is something we called that highest paid person's opinion in the room. But to be honest, things have changed right now, right? It's not completely safe, right? For example, senior folks, executives, it doesn't matter who is in the room. And even if their opinions are relevant, but you are a data scientist in the room, you can influence what should be done, right? So you are thinking to yourself as a data scientist, like, when you guys are finished arguing about your opinions, I actually have data which can let you know what to do, right? So that is how the world and the companies are evolving from opinions to data-driven decisions, right? So that is a very easy cartoon way to put how things are really working out. Just a moment. Yeah. Good. Just checking once again if everyone can just clearly hear me. I think should be okay. Good. So now what we'll do is we'll cover about different degrees of analytics, right? So there are four brief layers, right? One, starting with descriptive analytics. So what descriptive analytics means is just letting your company stakeholders, teams know what is happening in the business, right? What has happened so far? So for example, let's take a team, probably your data science team in a company. You report how much sales has been happening month on month, right? So you look into the data that every month our sales are growing by 5 to 10%, right? So that is a descriptive analytics where you have some reporting dashboards, visualizations to show that across Southeast Asia, every country, this is the growth we are observing, right? Now, this is informative, yes. Is it great? Yes, good to know how your business or product is doing. But the next part comes is, for example, you saw this report and then you saw that for last 2 months, your sales have gone down by 30%. Now, that is a fact. That's a number which you know is happened. Now, what's more interesting is if you can identify why it happened, right? That is what we call diagnostic analytics, where we go into the data and try to understand root causes, confounding factors, to see why a certain trend is happening in the region, right? Probably you started looking across different countries and you saw that out of 10 countries, only 3 countries saw a decline. That is first insight. Then you might go and see that, is there a seasonal impact? That is there any seasonal festivities or something which could have led to drop? That could be one way to look at it. Were there any external factors, right? Were there too much rain? Were there any floods? Was there any natural aspects which could have impacted sales? Another way to look at the metric or revenue or sales, right? Or was there any additional new competitor in the market? That could be another dimension. Other aspects could be, as a company, did we launch something which consumers didn't like and or they were not able to use the app or the website or so on, right? So diagnostic analytics tells us what happened and why it happened, right? So that's so why we need to do it so that we can fix it, we can take some actions and so on. But still, descriptive and diagnostic both are happening in the past, that what happened and why it happened. The more interesting and the fun part comes is the next part, where it's predictive analytics, that what's likely to happen, right? If we can identify that is sort of very valuable information. So for example, if you can already predict that for next month, my sales will be down by 7%, right? Now you have that information. Can you intervene and make some products, interventions, campaigns, which can change it? And rather than having a drop, you can see some gains, right? So that is where your predictive analytics would come into picture. And this is the whole, the subsequent slides and sections will talk about some predictive analytics frameworks, what kind of algorithms exist, and so on, right? Last but not the least would be prescriptive analytics, that what do I need to do once we know what will happen? So think from a perspective that there are always limited resources and constraints, and every team, every company operates under certain constraints and resources. So what's the best way for recommended actions and strategies based upon the different outcomes we want to automate, right? So that is somewhere your prescriptive analytics would come in. Now, ideally, we would think that ideally everyone should be doing predictive and prescriptive, because that will let us know the unknowns, right? But it's more complex as well as it gets more value, right? So that is on the visualization you see on the left-hand side. As we go from out to the outer layers, it is more complex, but at the same time, it gives more value. But that said, it doesn't mean we don't need these. Everything is needed, because it's a step-by-step process based upon the maturity of the team, company, value needed. All have to follow a step-by-step process, right? So I hope this gives everyone's breadth of analytics which can be captured. So moving on to the next part, now we'll talk about a data science framework, right? So idea here is to see that if there is any problem which as a data scientist you experience in your day-to-day, what all goes behind the scenes for that, and what are the critical aspects of the problem. So one of the first and the most important parts of this would be identifying the problem, right? It is the first and the most important aspects, I would say, any data scientist, any team has to invest most time in, right? The idea behind this is that when you work with the data, you can identify probably there are hundreds and thousands of problems which can be solved. But do we need to solve all of them? Probably not, right? That's why identifying the problem, having a good domain knowledge, and identifying the most impactful problems for the business to solve. That is one of the important aspects of being a data scientist, knowing what to ask, what kind of questions to ask, how do we define the impact once we solve this problem, how this will help the company meet their OKRs, KPIs, and so on, right? So this is the foundational aspect, which is the most important part. So let's assume that you have done this. And for example, let's assume we take about XYZ company and let's come up with a problem around user retention or churn, right? So for example, there is an e-commerce company, and they find that only 60% of the users come back every month, right? Who transact this month, only 60 of them will come next month. 40% of them won't come back. Is this great? Probably not, because company would want users to keep coming back every month, right? So that's a problem you have identified. You have identified the scale. What would happen if you improve user retention, right? How will this help the company grow in long-term customer experience and so on? So that has been established for now. So the next part in this process, which will be very time consuming, right? The next two parts would be collecting the raw data, right? I'm not sure if few of you have worked already on this, but now if we have the problem, the data would be existing in different data lakes and multiple sources, right? For example, there could be one data lake with all the user demographics, like what's his age, city, and other socioeconomic aspects of that, right? There could be one data which is purely transactional. How many transactions a customer make, how much money he spends, what kind of products he purchases, how frequently he purchases, what time of the day of the week of the month, right? So there could be a lot of dimensions we want to look at from the raw data perspective. The other part could be the experience of the customer, right? So for example, if a consumer comes to a company, he made an order, what was it delivered on time? Was it delayed? Was it canceled? Was his experience good? How much rating he gave? What kind of review he left, right? So there could be an experience side of the things as well. So we combine all of them into a single data source for all our consumers, right? So that we have a overall a holistic view of every consumer, what they do on the website or the app. Once we have it, the next step and out of the all, this would be time-consuming, important aspects, because everything after that will be dependent upon this, is processing the data, right? So examining the data at a high level, cleaning the data, because nobody likes it, but the truth is that all the data is, no data is clean, right? Like, you won't have a data which is 100% clean. There will always be some noise, some missing values, some outliers, right? Or missing value, you can think of, we collected users' age, some users didn't enter the age, right? So you have 10% of users where age is not available. Outliers could be that some users entered age as a 250, 300, 400, right? Which is not probably feasible, right? So that those are outliers in the data. So how do we process this, make it clean, which can be used for any analysis or any modeling exercises? The next part would be exploring the data. So let's assume you merged all the data sources, you process the data, and you would want to invest time in diagnostic analytics, what we mentioned on the previous slide, where you form a lot of hypotheses, do descriptive analytics, do diagnostic, and then visual inspection of the data. That what is exactly happening, right? Is there a variation in retention across countries, right? That could be an easy catch for you. Is there age group difference? Is there a gender difference? Is there a location or user age on the platform, right? Users who purchase certain kind of products have a better retention, right? So you would come up with all these questions, and that's why having a domain knowledge is very important, because the better domain knowledge you have, you'll be able to come up with better hypothesis. Better hypothesis leads to better investigation of the data and eventual analysis. So now we have done the hypothesis, analysis, and so on. The next, and I think everyone over here would be very curious, is performing in-depth analysis, where we create predictive models, right? When we talk about neural networks, random forest, and all that cool stuff where we hear AI and everything. So that is where it happens. Now, one thing to observe is, this is one of the six steps, right? But the only thing we talk about is this most of the times, or we read about this, but this follows after 1 to 4, only then this is feasible, right? So this is very important, but we have to also ensure the other parts are equally and very important as well. Last but not the least would be communicating the results, right? So one of the very easy traps as a data scientist is we go very technical, we build very complex models and so on, which are great, right? Which have a value for the company. But eventually, as a data scientist, you would need to communicate those complex algorithms, results, insights to an actionable story, right? Because the whole idea of solving a problem was some actions could be taken, right? So how do we translate those insights, model outcomes, predictions, to a non-technical audience so that they could implement, take actions, and improve the businesses, right? So that is where a storytelling aspect would come into picture, which is a communicating the results, right? And then you will be monitoring the results and so on. But at a high level, this is a framework which sort of fits pretty much every problem out there. So that's what we look at, right? I do see there are some questions out there, but I hope a few of these will get answered throughout. But yeah, I'll try to cover most of the questions towards the end of the session. But yeah, please keep your questions coming in. Those are very important. Cool. So now we'll try to look at some predictive analytics algorithm, right? So this is the step 5, which we spoke on the previous slide, right? Within that, what's the classification? So the first set is supervised learning, which is how do machines learn by using labeled data to achieve a certain predefined outcome, right? So the example we just took about churn prediction, right? Or predicting sales, right? Or image classification, right? So all these are supervised learning because there's already a predefined outcome we are trying to predict, right? So in the example, you can see there are green crosses and blue circles, right? So there is a predefined goal we are trying to say that if there is a new data point, whether that will be a circle or a cross, right? So we know what we are trying to predict. There is labels to that. The next part would be unsupervised learning, right? Which is how do machines learn by using unlabeled data to discover underlying hidden patterns, right? One of the most common examples would be customer segmentation, right? And we'll see some examples as well. But think of, as a company, there are 1 million customers, right? Now every customer has a identifier, right? Like 1, 2, 3, let's number every customer. Every customer looks similar. But is every customer similar? Probably not, right? There are inherent differences in every customer. Can we group those customers into certain clusters so that one group is very similar to one another, other group is similar? And now, for example, if you run a marketing campaign, you can target different customer profiles in different ways. For example, green is one group of customers, red and blue. Now, all these is your exhaustive customer base, but red is very different from green. Green is different from blue and red and so on. So if you have to target a strategy, you could have a different strategy for green versus red versus blue, right? So we did not have a predefined outcome, but we had all the customers and we could have come up with 3, 4, 5 clusters of customers, right? So that's how unsupervised learning looks like. The next would be reinforcement learning, right? This is more of a more advanced topics, but at a high level, how it looks like is agent interacts with the environment by producing certain actions and discover rewards or errors, right? Based upon this, it will keep relearning and so on. One of the common examples you may have heard is around self-driving cars, where this is very common application, or a lot of gaming aspects as well. Now we'll move ahead and talk in depth or go further into supervised machine learning, right? Because this is one of the most common algorithms or a category of algorithms, I would say at a high level, which has the most applications in industry, right? Like the most common problems could be solved by supervised machine learning, or most problems have this. So think of that you have a lot of images, right? So you have all the cat images, which are labeled as these are cats. Right, so this is what we spoke of on the previous slide about label data. So you feed all these images to your machine learning algorithm. Machine would learn, you will have some neural network, some predictive models to learn, okay, these are the attributes of cat, that if there are 2 ears, eyebrows, and so on, that then this looks like a cat. Now you feed the machine new set of images, but you don't provide labels. Right. For example, you could take an image of a cat, a dog, a bird, or a horse. It could be any image. Then you feed that unlabeled information to the model which you trained with the goal to see whether the machine is able to identify whether these are cats or not. Right. So once you feed the new unlabeled data over here, the output would be like cats and not cats. Right. So one of the interesting observations here is it's cats, which was expected because the labels were cat. But over here, you know, these are dogs, but machine doesn't know these are dogs, right? Like it's not that machines are dumb or something. It's just that the input data was just cats, right? So machine doesn't know what anything else outside that. So for machine, everything they learned was whether it's a cat or anything else is not a cat. Could we change it, make it better? Yes, right? We could have the input images of cats and dogs. Then the machines will be able to identify these are cats, these are dogs, and this is everything else, right? So based upon the input labels, the output and the machine learning models will be trained. Now we'll go further, right? So within supervised machine learning, there are further 2 classifications or 2 categories of the problems which can be suited. One is classification regression or classification and regression, right? So the classification is probably what we saw, cats and not cats, right? So this is a simple classification problem, whether a customer will make a purchase or not, or whether a customer will buy a certain product or not, whether the customer will churn or not, right? So all these are classification problems. Regression is a continuous scale, right? Identifying the real values. So you can think of how much a customer will spend. So we're not saying whether a customer will spend or not, but it's how much money he'll spend on the platform, right? Predicting weight, predicting the prices of a stock, right? So all these are regression problems, which is on a continuous scale, right? So these are the 2 high-level supervised learning problems which can be solved. Now what we'll do is we'll look into some data, right? Because we have been talking about some algorithms and stuff, but let's get things going so that eventually we can look some action as well, have some action on the coding part as well. So take a very simple data, right? And again, very simplistic data over here for just a demo perspective, right? So think of there is a iris flaw for which we have data. So how do we read the data when we talk about a data science perspective? So every row over here is called an observation. Every column here would be called a feature. And then there is a class label, right, which we can try to predict for that. So now how the data or the summary of the data is that there are 150 observations, so that there are 150 flowers. For each flower, we know its sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. And then we know what's the type of the flower. So there are three categories of flower. What is setosa, versicolor, and virginica, right? So 150 observations, four features, three types of flowers. Now the goal should be that if we have a new 151 observation here with sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, based upon these four features, can we confidently predict what type of flower it is, right? So if we can do that, that is the data science. That is the predictive analytics, that if we know certain things, can we predict what outcome that will have? Okay. So keep moving, right? So how would this happen intuitively, right? So there are known labels, which is the three flowers, right? Setosa, versicolor, and virginica. You have your known features. We combine these to feed it into the machine learning algorithm. We train the model, and then we feed a new data, right? What I was giving example, that a new observation with no labels, but only the sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. Based upon this, we will try to find a predicted label, that what kind of flower it is, right? So how it will look like? You have three known labels, four known features. You build your model, have input data, which is new, right? Which was not used for training the machine learning model. Based upon these four features, you will be able to predict what type of flower it is, whether it's a setosa, versicolor, or virginica. Now, you can think of this exact framework and pretty much translate into any other problem we mentioned or will talk in the future, right? It's a customer retention problem, right? Whether a customer retains or not, or the best customer churn or not, what kind of features we have? We build the model. For any new customer, if we feed the new inputs, whether a customer will return or not in future, right? So pretty much similar framework which can be applied to most data science problems. So now talking about what unsupervised machine learning looks like, right? So this is the second category under the data science algorithms, right? So only difference here from the supervised learning is there are no labels, right? So we are not trying to predict anything. We are trying to find patterns in the data, right? So it's a very easy way to put that. So for example, you have a lot of images of cats and dogs, right? Or you can think of random images of random animals or so on. Can we use machine learning algorithms to classify them into certain groups, right? And we don't care whether a group, what's the name of the group, whether it's cats or dogs. We want a group of animals, or in this case, images, which are similar to one another and different from the other group. For example, in this case, because intuitively as human beings, we can understand what's happening. There is one group with cats, one with dogs. But can we translate this into further, right? For example, clustering or anomaly detection. For example, in clustering, identifying similar group of customers in one group to another group, what we spoke previously, right? That's called clustering. Anomaly detection is sort of, you can think of problems like anti-money laundering, right? If there is a small segment of consumers or transactions which seems anomalous, right? Or any sort of fraudulent activity or any hacker intruding at the network, right? So identifying abnormalities, which could be one separate group from everything which looks normal, right? So that is another way, area where unsupervised machine learning would be actively used. So now what we'll do is we'll look into some coding aspects of this. So what I'll do is, so you don't need to think and share or do coding right now, but let me share the link with everyone. So if you open the link, what will you see is something like this, right? So what you can do here is go to file, right? Save a copy in Drive, right? So once you do that, you will create a copy of this whole code on your end. But just setting some expectations there, right? The idea behind showing you code is not you implement or execute the code right now. The idea would be to put some things we speak about in action so that you can see how things look like and so on. You can follow along and you don't need to execute anything because the code, data, the recordings, everything will be shared with you. The idea is so that after the session, you can go back on your own time, look in detail and see what happened, how it happened, and so on, right? But yeah, so this is a Python notebook and we are using Google Colab, right? So pretty much accessible to everyone. So no need to set up anything on your local machines. Everything is on cloud, right? So yeah. So what happening here is, so this is a commit part, right? So anything you want to execute, you just click Shift Enter for people who's using Mac. And over here, you'll see it is executing, connecting, and so on, right? So starting, I'm assuming everyone is able to access. Please let me know in the chat section if anyone is not able to access the link, right? So this is where we write the coding bit, right? And very, very simple, just to show what's happening. So for example, just a simple mathematical computation, right? You can click this to run or just click Shift Enter. So these are very simple mathematical computations, right? Or just printing hello world and so on, right? So I'll skip this and go to the more fun part over here. This is where we'll start, and we use the same data which we used in the Iris section, right? So we import certain packages and libraries, right? The first one is matplotlib. This is used for a lot of visualizations we'll see. And then sklearn, which is the foundation or one of the very important libraries, which has a lot of data sets and a lot of predictive analytics algorithms and packages directly to input, right? So let's run this. Now from sklearn, we imported data sets. From data sets, there is Iris data, which already exists by default, right? So which we will be using for the practice. Now, if we try to look what Iris data looks like, right? So it looks something like this, right? So there is something called, let me see, this is, let's zoom on that as well. Right, so there is this data, right? And if you keep scrolling, then there are feature names, sepal length, width, petal length, petal width. Then there is a target variable, 0, 1, and 2. And then target names, which is setosa, vesica, virginica. So if you see, the information is pretty much same what we saw on the slides in a very neat structured table, right? But over here, it looks pretty chaotic, right? Like it's an arrays format, right? Not a very human readable format over here, right? So what we'll try to do is translate this into a more human readable format with rows and columns and a neat column names and so on. So what we'll do is from this, we'll import iris.data in iris feature, iris.target in iris labels, right? Now there is a function called shape, right? The idea is to check the dimensions of the data, right? For example, if I do iris feature dot shape, it tells me there are 150 observations and 4 columns, right? Columns would be sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, and those values for 150 flowers or 150 observations, right? If you look at the data, this is how. Now we don't have anything else. We just have these values over here, right? Now, if you remember the 6-step data step framework we spoke about, we identified a problem. So we have that we want to predict the type of flower if we given that. We collected the data, right? This is a very simplistic way to get the data, right? In real world, you will need to spend time to that. Now, the next part was processing and exploring the data, right? So we'll quickly go through this, right? So for that, we import something called pandas, right? And then convert our data over here into a data frame, right? So we use pd pandas.data frame, iris features, column names is iris feature names, right? Just to check if everything is working fine, we look at the shape again and it's still same, right? So it's pretty much similar. Now we'll try to look how the data looks like, right? After we converted the data using a data frame or to a data frame, this is how your data looks like. Now, this is similar to what we saw on the previous slides, which is a more human readable format, where you have the row observation, then features, sepal and sepal width. So you can pretty much read how the data looks like, right? Now, one thing we don't have here is the label, right? So let's try to look at that. But just the data, you can use head for top 5 observations, right? So let's assume we want to click top 10 observations, right? We just type top 10 and so on. Then similarly, there will be tail for the bottom 10 or bottom 5 observations. Then we import another package called seaborn, right? This is for visualizations. So one plot we'll look at here is pair plot, right? So we'll do seedborn.payplot on iris features data field, right? Too many plots, right? Like that's the first thought you will have. So there are two things happening, right? So, right. So what's happening here is, so we only have four features. What we're doing is for every feature, let's say sepal length, we are trying to look at the distribution. So the plot here is called a histogram, right? These are histograms. What's the distribution of sepal width in the data? The plots with the dots, right? Over here, these are called scatter plots. So what we're trying to do here is I'll try to annotate a bit here. So for example, we are trying to see what's the distribution of probably sepal width over here, right? So we know that this is the scale for sepal width. Most of the flowers would follow normal distribution with sepal width of 3, right? But there are very small flowers which have very high sepal width, right? But if you look at petal width, right, the distribution is very different. Petal width, majority of the flowers is 0 or 1, or probably around less than 0.5. And then there are, it's a more of a uniform distribution, right? There are equal number of flowers, and petal length was very different. Similarly, sepal length again is relatively uniform, and so on, right? So this in itself gives an idea about some data parts or what's happening. The other part is there are these scatter plots over here, right? So this is probably a linear correlation, what we see, right? What we're trying to see is how petal length and petal width are correlated. So probably there is this group of flowers over here, which is having very small sepal petal length and petal width. And then there is this group flower, which as your petal length increases, your petal width increases, right? So some stuff happening over here. Is this insightful? Yes. Can we learn something over here? Probably few yes, few no's, right? How do we make it better, or why do we need this, right? So let's see that. Probably based upon this, you can already see there is this group which is very different. But if you look at sepal length, sepal width, there is no clear pattern, right? So a lot of stuff is happening over here. Now, if we try to overlay the labels of the flowers on this, because we know there are 150 observations, right? So what we'll do is on the same pair plot function, we'll add a hue for species class. Species class is the type of flower. So let's try to do that and see what happens. Yeah. So the same thing, but slightly different, right? Now, the histogram, which was overall 150 observations, now that is split into 3 species classes or 3 types of flowers. Now you can see clear patterns that species class 0 has lowest sepal length, as species class 2 has the highest sepal length. Species class 0 or probably 1 and 2 have pretty much same sepal width distribution, but different. And this small cluster over here, which we were seeing, is always species class 0, right? So now you can, we haven't gone into the predictive analytics part, but just based upon visual inspection, data processing, exploration, hypothesis formation, we can uncover some patterns in the data. This is a very simple problem, simple data set. Now imagine the same thing in your real use cases. That's why the visualization, data exploration are very critical aspects of any data science journey or experience, right? So this is what visual inspection or the data exploration would look like. Now we'll come to something cool, which everyone is waiting for, is building your first predictive analytics model. Right. So from sklearn model selection, the first step is usually to split the data into train and test. That rather than using 100% of the data, can you split that randomly into 80 and 20%? Right. So let's do that. What we'll do is iris feature labels, and then we'll create X train, which is X test, Y train, Y test. And then test size is 20%. Why do we do that? Right. That's a one question which usually comes as to have unbiased predictions on the test data, right? So that we build the model on the train data, which is 80% of the data, and then we check the accuracy or the results on the test data, right? That's what we will be doing over here. And if there are questions, we'll go and take that later on this part as well, right? Now, because we've taken 80% and 20%, if we took the train data, initially there were 150 observations, if you remember correctly. Now 80% of that leads to 120 observations here. The test data is 30 and so on, right? So skipping this. The model we will be using here now is from neighbors to import K neighbors classifier, right? So this is called a KNN model. This is one of the most simplistic models out there, but it's a foundation for more advanced pieces. Right? That's why it's always important to learn the mathematics or how the algorithms work in the initial model, so that when you go to the advanced random forest XGBoost, so that you know how it works. Right. So what this model does is, for every data point, it will look into n near neighbors and see what their type was. So for example, if we have one flower over here, and if we choose five neighbors, so it will see that for this new data point, what are the closest five flowers look like? If all the close five flowers are versicolor, so for this unknown new flower, it will say it's a versicolor. Or if there are three setosa to virginica, it will say it's a setosa. So it's a weighted, or it's a voting kind of a method, right? Based upon a data point, what are the nearest neighbors and so on. So let's import this. Now we'll fit the model on train and test. Let's do that. Right, let's skip this. And then, as I mentioned, the predictions will happen on the test data set. That's, so you fit the model, you train the model here, you do the predictions over here, and this is your prediction data set. Right. So for these 20 observations, you have the predicted values. But now, if you remember, you also have the actual value over here, right? So this is actual and this is the predicted. Now you can already see that it's simple, very similar, for example, but this is 1, 2, 1, this is 1, 1, 1. So probably for this flower over here, right, our predictions are wrong. And that's expected. So let's see what, and these are 20, you can look one by one, but in real world you will be having thousands and millions of data points, so we need better way to see the accuracy of the model. So we import something called accuracy score from sklearn. We look at shape, and now we look at the accuracy for the train and the test data set, right? So what we are more concerned is the testing data accuracy. What we compare is accuracy score for y test, which is the actual value, and the prediction test set, which is the predicted value. Wow, we have like 96.67 accuracy. Sounds very great. And to be honest, did we spend a lot of time building this model? No. Did we do imputation cleaning? No. Because this was already a very, very small data set, very clean, tidy, so on, for the demo purpose. The framework remains same, but the accuracy, probably will you get every time this high? No, most likely not. But the idea is the steps would pretty much remain same. Right, and that is the idea, so that you know how the accuracy or the training predictions work. So that is a supervised learning, which we just saw. Right, so let's skip this. Now we'll go to the unsupervised learning. Right, so now we had four features, right? Sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width. Let's take just three of them, sepal length, sepal width, and petal length, for the visualization purpose, so that we can look into a 3D plot for this. Now, if you look plot into a 2D plot, you already see that we saw this, there was one cluster at the bottom, and then there was one over here. Now, let's assume we don't have labels for a moment. Let's forget about versicolor, virginica, setosa, and so on. We don't have any labels. Let's assume somebody gave us these data points and told us these are flowers. Can you identify, group them into certain colors and let us know what it is, right? Or easier ways, think of as a all the customers in a company, and you want to run a marketing campaign. And you know that if I send the same marketing campaign to every customer, it won't be best use case or best way. How can we optimize the marketing campaigns across group of customers, right? That's a problem we have. How do we do that? We use something called k-means cluster, right? Again, from sklearn.cluster, import k-means. Now, for example, let's take that we want to make five clusters of this data, right? How do we have five? There are a few statistical ways to do that, which is called elbow method. I leave it to you guys to read something. Or there is always a business context on what actions we want to do, and this number could be influenced by that. So we create KM with five clusters. We fit it on the iris features, and then we predict it, right? And then we look at what's happening. let's plot. So this is the raw data we had. Now we want to split this into 5 clusters. Let's look how it looks like. Wow. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. But for just this example, we add bias because we know there are, three. We know in real there were 3 flowers. We already have that information, but let's not use the labels, but see that if we have to identify, will this help us? Yes. So there is one, this, second, and third. Without the labels, we were able to classify what kind of flowers there are, right? Similar translating the what I mentioned on consumers. Now you have over here one group of customers. Probably you can run an email campaign for this. You can run a loyalty campaign for this, and then probably you give more promos and discounts to this, right? So you know that there are these customers, probably these are very price-sensitive customers or promo-sensitive customers. These are your loyal customers, right? And these are average customers, which we need to target and let them know there are these customers, or probably these are new customers. So based upon different dimensions of the customers, you can take different actions and recommend that. All right, so that is the part where I was mentioning about the communication of the results. So you have done this, but how do you translate and make these actionable? That is the last and very, very important aspect of any data science problem we have. Right. So that's all we had for the coding part. I hope everyone learned something, enjoyed something over here, but we will share this with you so that you can look into the code data at your end as well. All right. Now we'll quickly talk about some of the applications in data science industry, right? One of the favorites and which I'm always quite amazed is Amazon, right? Now Amazon recommendations are great, right? I hope everyone has used Amazon, or if not, a equivalent of Amazon could be Lazada, Shopee, or in India, Flipkart, and so on. And so there are a lot of e-commerce companies. And the foundation of what we see on when we open the app is pretty much data science recommendations, right? So over here, we have this book called Introduction to Statistical Learning, right? I have 2 motives or objectives of putting this slide here. One was to talk about Amazon recommendations. The other was, this is a great book, great resource for anyone who wants to learn the data science. This is considered as the Bible for people getting started on the data science aspects. The good thing is, for those who want a hardcover, great, but this is a freely available ebook as well from the authors, right? A great book to learn about data science and getting started in that. That's a one hidden motive I had behind this. But coming to the other important part, which is about your data science recommendations, right? So what's happening here is that when you search for a book or any product, let's assume a mobile phone or an iPhone, right? Anything. So what will happen is you will see what you searched for, but there are a lot of other recommendations which will be happening in parallel. For example, Amazon will show that frequently bought together, right? For example, say the people who buy this, they also purchase this and this book together. So they're bundling the items together. And this is a similar thing you will see in a lot of retail stores as well, where during festivals or so on, they create bundles, right? Or if you go to McDonald's, right, you see Happy Meals or some combo meals from all the restaurants and so on. And how do they come up with that? They know that people buy a burger and a Coke together. Probably let's create a combo for that. Why? Probably the sales will also increase and the customer experience will also improve. That is one part which is happening, and this is data driven. The other thing you see and the same page when you scroll down is customers who bought this also bought this, right? Now, probably you may not want to spend $200 right now, but you are saying that probably customers who buy this item also buy these items. And why do they show this? Probably you read the description, you find that book is expensive or whatever reasons. They're telling that if you're not interested in this book, other books is something you may be interested in. Similarly, you may view this, but you're not interested. They say, what other items do customers buy after viewing this item? So the very slight difference in the this and the top one. The top one is people buy these after purchasing this book. The bottom ones are the customers buy this after viewing this. So they did not purchase this book, but they ended up buying these books, right? Why is this happening? Is Amazon would want to convert a customer who is viewing these books to a transaction. If they don't do these recommendations, probably you might be a beginner. You don't know which books to look at and so on, right? So they're improving your experience as well And then at the same time, it helps Amazon as well, right? So it's a win-win for both consumers and the companies. The other example, again, one of my favorites and a huge fan of Netflix, right? So the internal Netflix released an article long back was that 80% of what people watch on Netflix comes from their recommendations, right? And recommendations are driven by machine learning algorithms, right? But at the same time, I also feel as a consumer, I personally spend a lot of time browsing to watch rather than watching. So that's too much content out there probably. But I think, yeah, we all know that it's very rare we go and search something, but we just browse certain things, certain shows, and then the recommendation will keep improving, and then we watch something which is shown on the home feed. So that is one part where Netflix has an edge over a lot of companies around recommendations. The other part, and sort of very interesting, and could be very new and slightly different from the machine learning aspects we spoke till now, was experimentation, right? Some of you may know, some of you may not know, but pretty much think of that every one of us is part of some experiment around some company or the world around there, right? So again, one of the shows I really love was watching Stranger Things, right? And I'm pretty excited about with the new teaser, which has come out, or trailer, I think, right, for the next season. But yeah, not going or drifting towards that, but think of it as these are 16 or like 12 images or nine Stranger Things images over here. And why do they have this, right? So these are the thumbnails for Stranger Things show. And every one of us, when we open the app, could probably be seeing a different thumbnail. How and why, right? Because they would want to click the conversion rate or the click-through rate, that based upon the image, whether you click and watch it or not, right? Because the first intent is capturing that person clicks on the show or watch a trailer or a teaser, or first episode at least. Now, probably people who love kids shows, right? They might show the picture in the middle or this one, but people who love sort of a horror thriller shows, they may show this one or this one. They don't love romantic shows and so on. So based upon what kind of genre or kind of movies, series you love, right? They would change the thumbnails for that, right? Sounds very interesting, creepy, could be different ways. Sorry, right? But for example, for Good Will Hunting, based upon a comedy fan or a romance fan, you may see a different thumbnail. For Riverdale, a romance or a thriller, and so on. So this is just Netflix. Similar things around every tech company, around every company in a different ways or formats is done to learn consumer behavior, what works, what doesn't work. And that is a whole area of experimentation, right? Which is a topic for some other day, but super interesting part or the potential of experimentation. Right. Now I'll quickly show you a very small video, right, on facial recognition, on how Alipay uses that for something called Smile to Pay in China. Right. So let me play the video. Great, right? So the reason to show this was to just show that how advanced algorithms in neural networks face recognition exist. And even if you put all the filters, makeup, add more people in the image or the video, it will still be able to recognize the person, right? So one of towards the last few examples, right? The other pretty interesting example is about Spotify, right? And how it pretty much changes the way we consume music writers, right? So one of the, just some numbers again, very descriptive part, now again, descriptive analysis you spoke about, is the Spotify is keeping Apple Music at an arm's length, right? Probably a debatable topic, yes, right? But just like based upon the number of paid subscribers worldwide, right? Spotify has over 100 million subscribers, whereas Apple Music as of 2019 had 60 million, right? But why is this happening, right? People love Spotify, right? Some of the tweets which I was creating this came across was like, Spotify's Discover Weekly knows me so well that if it proposed, I'd say yes. It's scary how well Spotify Discover Weekly playlist knows me. Like a former lover who lived through a near-death experience with me. Right? So the tweets here shows people love the recommendations and how well these recommendations are tuned to your personal preferences. So again, talking about a very intuitive way to understand how this is happening. You listen to certain songs, you say create your own playlist. Billions of playlists by millions of users created out there every day, right? Now, Spotify, based upon what you listen as a user, Spotify will develop your taste profile. Now, what is taste profile? We'll look in a moment. And based upon what you are listening or what kind of songs you're saving to your playlist and what are the other playlists around the world, Spotify identifies similar songs that appears on those playlists. Right now, Spotify has your taste profile. Spotify knows the songs you exist, listen to, and similar songs which exist in the other playlist. So based upon these two informations, Spotify finds the songs that fit your profile, but that you haven't listened to. Based upon that, they create something called Discover Weekly. And we all know most of the times it's pretty relevant songs on that. But what are the taste profile? How do Spotify knows what I like, right? So they usually classify everything into four categories at a high level. The first is whether you listen to very mainstream music or not, whether you listen to very newly launched songs or not, right? Whether you listen to a very diverse genre of music or you are very specific certain genre. And then the last is the discovery, that how often is it that you start listening to certain songs which become popular later on, like super blockbusters and so on, right? So based upon these four criteria, Spotify will have your taste profile. Based upon that, they will identify songs across the playlist which suits these taste profile and create the discovery for you. Sounds very fascinating, right? And one of the last examples we'll talk about is about virtual assistants, right? Siri, Google, and so on are investing a lot. So over here, we'll see an example of a Google Duplex, how a Google assistant is able to help as a consumer to make reservations, right? And how human this looks like.
Hey Google, book a table for two at El Cocotero on Tuesday at 7.
All right, just in case that's not available, can I try between 7 p.m. and 8 p.m.?
Sure.
All right, I'll call to book under your name and phone number, and I'll update you in the next 15 minutes. Is that okay?
Perfect, thanks.
El Cocotero, how may I help you?
Hi, I'm the Google Assistant calling to make a reservation for a client. This automated call will be recorded. Can I book a table for Tuesday the 12th?
Okay, cool. And how big is the party?
It's for two people.
Great. And when did you say they want to come in?
Tuesday at 7 p.m.
Okay, let me check.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have 7, but we can do 8.
Yeah, 8 p.m. is fine.
Perfect. And can I get their name?
The first name is Anna.
Okay. We'll see Anna Tuesday. Thank you.
Okay, awesome. Thanks a lot.
Anna for two.
Right this way.
Great. So right, so this just shows the probably the great work which is done by Google on Google Assistant and how human way it can book, make a reservation on your behalf and understand the context behind that. Like if certain times are not available, what to do and so on. Right? So it pretty makes like super easy waiting for it to come out. Coming to one of the last slides we have for today, right? I think now if you take a quick recap what we did today, right? We started with what data science is. Why do we need a data science? Talking about HIPPO and data-informed ways. Then we spoke about layers of data analytics, right? Four levels, descriptive, diagnostic, predictive, and prescriptive. Then we went further into predictive and spoke about supervised, unsupervised, and within that we saw some coding aspects and so on, right? So we have done that. Now, if you remember the academic definition we spoke about, right? So we spoke about for data science, you need some data, which is a foundation, but along with that, you need mathematics, computers, and domain knowledge, right? So these are the three key pillars, I would say. But now the first, and we saw some coding examples in Python today. All right. So what we'll do now is a very quick way to see that what you can do to learn or get started in your journey, assuming this is the intro to data science and a lot of you may be very curious to kickstart your journey, right? I think GA is here to help you guys. And I think Huang will share more context about that in next few slides on what are the possible places, programs up there. But along with that, I will also recommend some open sources, places where you can go and learn and he'll probably become a data scientist, right? So the first and the most foundational aspects of getting is on the first step over here. It's a get good at stats, maths, and machine learning, right? So there are a lot of open sources out there, to be honest, to get started. It's just sometimes there's too much information and then we get sometimes confused on where to get started, right? But you can start. This is a sort of 8-step framework, right? So start with maths at Khan Academy, or there is a MIT open courseware for linear algebra. So this is the first thing you can get started to get some foundations in mathematics for those who don't have that in past, right? So this is always helpful. Very, very important aspect would be statistics, right? Having intro to statistics or some open intro statistics courses. This will give you some foundation, right? Like what are different sort of hypotheses, right? So when we talk about, let's say, a regression, right, or a linear regression, what kind of assumptions does it follow, right? What kind of statistical tests I need to do about t-test, chi-square test, ANOVA, right? So p-values, right? So there will be a lot of statistical aspects in the all sort of algorithms you will use eventually. So statistics is one of the foundations which you should be investing time in. Third, and everyone knows and why we are here today, is ML, right? Machine learning. And one of the best courses out there is Machine Learning by Andrew Ng, right? Stanford, all available on Coursera for free. You can enroll, audit the course, right? And then to have more hands-on experience, there's another course called Practical Machine Learning by John Hopkins, right? So these are the two courses available on Coursera to learn about more algorithms. So today we saw KNN, K-means, but similarly, there are probably a way more advanced algorithms out there. So that will help you, right? So this is the first part, which is purely on the tech or the algorithmic and the knowledge side of things. The second and the most, and one of the other important pillars to get started in your data science journey would be the coding, right? Like coding is foundational or essential to your data science journey, right? So computer science fundamentals, important, right? And some other parts, right? So we won't go into detail, but I think one of the common questions which usually comes is what kind of tool we should use. We use an example for Python today. Is Python the only tool? No, right? Probably there is always an ongoing debate with Python and R, right? So both are relevant. If you know either of them, that's great. If you have to start totally new with one tool, I would say choose Python because the potential of learning Python is much higher. And the ROI or the number of things across companies, adoptions, algorithms. So Python is sort of better. R is more relevant in academia, I would say, but for or either more statistical aspects, right? So if you're into a role which is heavy on statistics, R may be more suited, but Python is something which should be able to cover most of the parts, right? So I would say choose Python in those cases, right? Again, right, so there are a lot of courses out there, books and so on, which you can learn this from. Third part is around databases, right? Which we spoke about when we talk about data science, data is the foundation, right? So how do we access the data, right? So if you remember in the six-step framework, the second step was collect the data, raw data. So there will be different data lakes, databases. How do we access that using SQL, NoSQL, MongoDB, right? So how do we access that? Having that knowledge is important as well. So in the first three parts, now you have databases, you know how to code, you know your algorithms and statistics, right? So you have covered probably 60 to 70% of whatever is needed. Now comes your, the more interesting parts, now implementation part, right? Or execution, where it's about data mining, visualizations and reporting, right? So everything we spoke about, descriptive and diagnostic, will come over here, right? About data cleaning packages, right? Today, what we saw in Python, the visualizations we did, right? So we used packages over there, right? So those are one way, right? The other part is when we spoke about descriptive analytics, we mentioned there could be certain dashboards or reports, right? So for that, different companies have different tools and so on, but pretty much you can always think for yourself to be tool agnostic, right? So for example, right now I'm using Tableau in my company, right? But eventually we'll be using Power BI and so on, right? So Tableau, Power BI, ClipView. So all these are relevant reporting and visualization tools, right? But just learn one, I would say that would be sufficient for you to start your journey in the data science, right? But visualization, reporting, data wrangling is a very important part. So the first four covers pretty much all the key foundations. Now it's a level up game after that, once you have a good control on the first four parts. Now, depending upon the scale of the data, right, or the kind of problems you face, you may want to work, have a big data infrastructure, and then you may be using Hadoop, Spark for that, right? So that is one. The next part is the most common things which people ask is that, how do we get started, right? Because how do we get experience? So you have worked from step 1 to 5 or 1 to 4, let's say. You know the tools, you know the coding, you know how to do everything. But till you get a job, you won't get an experience. And till you get an experience, people say that we want people with experience. So these are always two sides of the coin, which are very hard to find, right? So to get some experience or hands-on or practice, one of the go-to places is Kaggle, right? I hope few of you have heard because you are data science enthusiasts. So Kaggle is a place for data science competitions, right? But when I started my data science journey a few years back, when I got to know about Kaggle for the first time, I, to be honest, didn't go to participate in the competitions. I went there to just learn from the data science community, right? There are so many great Kagglers over there, or the data science community is so strong that just by observing or what's happening, you will be able to learn by observing on the way they explore the data, the kind of visualizations they make, the kind of diagnostic analytics they do. How do they treat missing values, outliers in the data, right? What kind of models they use, right? So there is way too much information to learn out there, right, from Kaggle itself. And then this also gives you a way to execute in parallel, right? Learn from a peer in the community and learn from that. The other parts would be there are a lot of meetups which happen. There are have a pet project, right? It could be purely on the unstructured data, right? You can use data from Twitter, Facebook, reviews, or IMDb, right? Or any freely available data sources as well, and learn on those parts, right? Seventh is purely getting for people in colleges or schools still, right? Or within internal companies as well, start a small internship, right? Or join a boot camp and so on, right? So as you do that, you will get more exposure, experience to real data and algorithms and solve the problems. Last but not the least here would be following and engaging with the community, right? Kaggle, as I already mentioned, but some other blogs and people you can also follow are listed here. But I usually follow KD Nuggets is one of the great blogs, right? If you want to stay updated on what's happening and so on, and Data Science 101, then there are a few people you can follow on Twitter, LinkedIn with pretty relevant, great posts about what's happening in the data science area. Cool. So Sorry, I think it was a lot, but I think this slide is very important for everyone. And I think we'll be sharing this with you. So go through that. And I hope this helps everyone. Cool. Thanks, everyone. So I think that's all I had on the data science side. But still, we have a few more slides. I'll ask you to share more on that.
All right, sure. Thank you so much, Raha. So hi everyone, I'm just back here to share a little bit more about some data science courses at General Assembly in case you are keen to find out more about, you know, how do you, now that you know that you are keen on this particular field, how do you then break into this field and become a data scientist? So maybe I can share a little bit more about some of our upcoming courses. So Raha, if I can just ask you to move to the next slide. Yeah, so as I mentioned earlier at the start of the session, we do have full-time courses. So this is specifically for those who are looking to make a career switch to join data science as a field. So when it comes to our career changing courses, we do have two different formats. We have it in full time as well as flexible classes. So these two, what are the difference between these two? They have the exact same curriculum. They have the exact same outcome. It's just that it really depends on whether you want to do it a little bit quicker or if you prefer to do it in like over a longer period. So if you can commit to it full time from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday to Friday, that's going to be 12 weeks of your time. And then if you prefer to spread it out over 24 weeks, there's also a flexible options. So those are usually on Tuesday and Thursday and also on Saturday as well. So for the schedules, we have the full-time one. Our next one will be on 27 September. Sorry, this is a bit of a while back. So I believe that we are almost out of Q4 courses. Our next one will be for Q1 2022. But we do have an upcoming flex options that's happening on 23rd November. So for those of you who prefer to something a little bit more flexible, then you can consider our 23rd November flexible course. Some of our courses do have subsidies available for Singaporean citizen and PR, but just drop us a note at the email. I'll drop it again in the chat later on, and our admissions producer will be able to help you out with that. And I believe, yeah. So again, if you are interested in the field, but you're not very sure if you want to completely switch into becoming a data scientist just yet, or you just want to pick up data science as a supplementary skill for your current role, then you can also consider our part-time classes. So this, I must say, is not as intensive as our full-time course. It's not meant for you to make a career switch, but it's really meant to boost your current data skills. These are intermediate level programs. So that means that you do need a little bit of data slash coding experience before you can join the program. These are usually 10 weeks and I think it moved back to the previous slide. Yeah, so just twice per week in the afternoon, evening, and on Saturday. Yeah, so the next course again, this is Q4. I think we're almost out of the Q4 course, but again, everything will be in the chat later on. And I will pass over the time back to Raka to go through the Q&A portion. I believe we have quite a lot of questions in there.
Yeah, so I was looking at it. Thanks, Wong, for this. And thanks, everyone, for listening patiently for last 1.5 hours. I hope everyone learned something new, right? So the whole idea, and again, all the slides, recordings, codes, everything will be shared with you guys.